Welcome back, everybody, to Game 2, Green Shoots Gaming versus LGD.CDEC. Man, this Game 1 just took me by so much surprise. Going into this, honestly, this is open qualifiers are always kind of like, So the open qualifiers for every single region it's always kind of like, okay, you're gonna have to cast a lot of stomps. It is basically what it comes down to. It's a good format for the scene. It allows certain teams, potentially like GSG, to be able to shine a bit and show off that they are one of the upcoming amateur teams of their region. But when it comes to casting those first couple of rounds and potentially the whole entire qualifier, they can just come down to being total stomps over and over again. But this is the one region that I was actually really excited to see, because we never, like all the other regions, the Middle Eastern region, we don't really cover that much, and we don't get to see those teams. So that was a unique experience, being able to maybe familiarize yourself a little bit with some of the teams in that region, some of the bigger names. And so that was kind of interesting. But the Chinese qualifier was really the one I was most excited about, because one, I knew that we more than likely we would have at least one amateur team that would be able to provide an upset. At least one. Like they're because of the fact the Chinese scene, I mean, it's so diverse, it's so complex. There's so many people playing Dota in China, and yet all you get to see is the top six teams. That's all you ever see from China. I mean, how many Chinese tournaments, how many Chinese games have we casted that involved pretty much all the same names? Now, the last tournament that the ESL won Chinese qualifier had some interesting names coming through. Of course, we've seen the rise of Dreamtime. So there are those teams that do make it, that do actually get some notice in some of the international tournaments. But more often than that, you don't really get to see more than one or two of those. It's just the same old teams, the top six, the top eight teams that are just cycling through and grabbing players from some of the amateur teams. Like if there's ever, there's always newer players. There's always newer players. And they probably played on one of these like amateur teams, but they've always been sniped away into one of the main organizations. So more often than not, you don't get to see teams like Green Shoots Gaming. And I have to say, like, I was putting it out on Twitter, and please, guys, put something out on Twitter, man. Put something out on Facebook, because I think this is just a shame. We all know, like, there's two other big tournaments going on right now. Later on, we're going to be casting iLeague, which will get a lot of viewers. And so, really, it's not a big concern for us. When we're like looking at Join Dota Blue, we've got 50 viewers. Like, totally expect that. You know, we'll get a bunch of viewers for iLeague later on, because we have teams that people are really excited about. Here, nobody, like, the team that people know is LGD.CDEC, and nobody really gets excited about that team. It's the junior team for a reason. Nobody really gets excited about Tong Fu anymore, because they've given up on professional. They focus more on the amateur side of Dota. Like, nobody is really getting excited about these names. And for me, that's totally fine. But I think it's a shame that Green Shoots Gaming is not actually going to get, they'll have their opportunity if they go into the main qualifier, but their performance in Game 1 was so amazing. That was such a clutch play from, for me, it was two different members. It was N9 and it was Leip. Like, Rubick and Centaur just made some amazing plays. Now, granted, I don't want to take away from Green Shoots Gaming. LGD got some serious issues to go over. I mean, they really screwed the pooch on that Game 1. But still, Green Shoots Gaming had some amazing individual play. It seems like their strategy was on point. Their drafting was perfectly acceptable. There was no obvious weaknesses that it really came out with. I love the OD 5th pick. I thought that actually displayed a large amount of... I thought maybe it was creative thinking, because I was actually kind of already set on the mid-Bat Rider. But actually changing up the lanes to have a one position Centaur and running that OD in the mid, that didn't really occur to me. So being able to read the enemy's draft and go, you know what, an OD pick would do so much here. I thought that was a great idea. The moment I saw that OD, I was like, wow, that's actually a brilliant pickup. So I'm excited about this team. I think that Green Shoots Gaming has the potential to be, you know, the next Dreamtime or something like that. But now that I'm done ranting, we got to talk about the draft. Batrider, Ember Spirit, Earthshaker, and Rubick for Green Shoots Gaming. Doom, Shadow Shaman, Ancient Apparition, and Lifestealer being picked up by LGD. You can see the list of bans. There's no real ones that really stick out to me on Green Shoots Gaming. They ban away the Invoker and the Brewmaster, some of those teamfight heroes they maybe didn't want to deal with. The Ember Spirit is interesting pickup this early on. We don't typically see Ember Spirit grabbed early on anymore, except for in like the hands of a team like maybe Ferrari. You know, that guy's just so good on Ember Spirit. So maybe they do have an Ember Spirit like that on their team. They have really long-range initiation between the Earthshaker and Dan Rubick. So I think there's enough control offered to them. They've got the pick-off potential as well. I don't think Green Shoots Gaming really have to worry too much. They do need another carry here, though, because they're facing up against the Doom. Like, that's the biggest issue right now, is that Green Shoots Gaming picked up an Ember Spirit into a Doom, and that can cause you some serious issues. For me, I'm very hesitant. I'm not sure why that was done. But we'll have to see. We'll have to see what LGD plan on doing here. Ancient Apparition and Lifestealer is... not quite curious pickups here. Like, the Ancient Apparition doesn't have an obvious setup. Like, the Shadow Shaman Ancient Apparition is amazing single target damage because you've got these really clutch disables from the Shadow Shaman, long duration, and OD once again for Green Shoots Gaming. So that was good. I mean, I felt like they needed another carry. They can't just rely on a single carry up against Doom. That's very obvious. OD is still going to be another great pickup up against all these heroes from LGD. Lifestealer is low intelligence. Doom is low intelligence. Doom doesn't pick up a BKB traditionally. Lifestealer, well, he's got rage. But if you're able to snipe him out while that rage is down. OD is a great hero up against Lifestealer in general. He's an early 4-staff buyer, so that actually works out really well in his favor up against a Lifestealer. Puck was banned away by Green Shoots Gaming, and I agree with that one. There does need to be a strong disabler in the mid for LGD because they have strong disables from the Shadow Shaman, but they don't have a truly strong initiator. Viper is going to be grabbed. So instead of focusing on maybe the mid-game initiation and being able to find those favorable team fights, instead they're going to go for a bit more lane control as the Viper is picked up. Viper is really the ultimate lane dominator. It's how he wins his game. If a Viper somehow manages to lose his lane in the first 10 minutes, the game is going to go very poorly from there, just because Viper really shouldn't. He may draw even with some heroes, but they are very specific heroes, and I don't really feel that OD is going to be... OD is one of the heroes that can do grow even with a Viper. I think Viper still has a slight edge, but... It's OD has still that big intelligence advantage, which is going to be able to offer him quite a bit. The advantage of Viper and why he's one of the heroes that can go up against an OD is the fact he's got that nether toxin. So he still does a good amount of damage when going for those last hits. Even one level of nether toxin, I mean, you're talking about an extra probably 30 damage at least when creeps are low health like that. So even if he's missing some intelligence and the OD is hitting much harder than him, Nether Toxin will still provide a lot. And I believe they should still be running an OD in the mid. Ember Spirit is not going to be a strong mid up against a Viper for obvious reasons. We are going to be seeing an aggro try out of LGD.CDEC, not quite of what I expected from them, as I was fully behind an offlane Doom here. Now, obviously, an offlane Doom would have some serious challenges, and he would probably have to go jungle full-time for maybe a couple of minutes, just because the Earthshaker, Rubick, and then Ember Spirit. Like, Ember Spirit is actually a rather strong one position when it comes to laning phase, because he brings his own disable to the table, and any carry that has their own disable is very threatening for solo offlaners. And that's why Doom is very oftentimes when he's in the one position and has those supports behind him, that's why I oftentimes call him a very weak laner, because he really doesn't add anything extra to the pool. He doesn't provide any extra threat against the offlane hero. And this is going to be, I was going to say a good start, but they're going to be running an aggro try of their own now in order to dodge LGD, it looks like. Rather curious, because I actually don't think this lane is that threatening. I certainly think LGD have a slight advantage, but I didn't think it was enough for you to be able to rotate your whole entire lane and be late to the laning phase a bit. But I guess they still want to go for that. Doom is definitely going to be shut down much harder than the Batrider will be. Batrider, of course, has pulls available to him, but he's also, once he picks up level 2, he can just go full-time jungle at that point in time. So it does make sense, right? Not necessarily because the tri-lane versus tri-lane engagement is that terrifying for GSG, but more the fact their offlaner is going to do so much better than the Doom. Doom can jungle on his own, but he's much slower jungler than a Batrider. And much more likely to be caught out. I mean, Scorched Earth does make you tanky, but as you can see, he went for the Devour level 1 because he is trying to jungle. And if he does get caught out in this point in time, and the telekinesis, Angel, and 9's going to be able to beautiful Fissure block. Look at that. And now here comes that burn damage over time. And eventually, it's not even necessary, but eventually they would have had the Searing Chains as well. First Blood goes the way of Green Shoots Gaming. But we may have a bit of a response here. Q sneaking right past the middle lane, as it looks like they're going to go bottom and combo up with the Doom. Now, this is going to lead a Batrider up against a Lifestealer. This is not too bad for a Lifestealer because he's got his Rage, so he should never really die in this lane. He may be harassed a little bit, but he's got the Sustained offered to him by Feast. The problem is, now I feel that it's actually Green Shoots Gaming that have the better tri-lane. But maybe when they get caught out like this, and 9 starts backing up, 2 supports being revealed, telekinesis, great response, thrown back into the Doom, but it's still going to be a kill onto the Rubick as he takes out from the Scorched Earth. So a good response there from LGD, reading the situation, realizing how much more the Batrider would be able to pick up, and rotating their supports accordingly. Middle lane, how's this lane doing? It is 12-4 compared to the 10-3 on the Vipers. So OD definitely doing a great job in this matchup. And you can see this is what happens. Not many Vipers actually do this. I would say that all of Viper's abilities are amazing. And I'm not saying there's anything inherently wrong with this build. In fact, I'm going to explain why it's very strong, but I would say 90% of Vipers do not go for Nether Toxin, being leveled up past level 1. Much more priority primarily into the Corrosive Skin or the Poison Attack if you want to be like very, very harassive and try and go for kills in lane. Ancient Apparition is going to be caught out as long as the Searing Chains land, which is why N9 is holding on to it until the creeps are away. Very smart, patient play there from our Ember Spirit. And now Fissure Block goes out. That's a beautiful Fissure Block. Ember Spirit's actually going to wrap around. There's going to be no escape. They turn around onto the Earthshaker, but this is not going to be a great fight for them. Q is definitely going to go down as he gets caught out by the Searing Chains. And right-click down. Angel, though. Oh, my God. N9. That damage from the Chilling Touch just overwhelming them. That's actually a 2-for-2 favorable for LGD, seeing as they picked up the last 2 kills there of the fight, resulting in a lot more experience for them than Green Shoots Gaming picked up. Both of the carries are going to pick up their phase boots at the same time. Oh, going back to the Corrosive Skin, Nether Toxin. The reason Nether Toxin is kind of essential here is because OD, not many heroes can really out-CS a Viper, but OD is certainly one of them. So having that extra bit of damage from Nether Toxin makes a big difference in the CS board. Now, we're getting a bit of lag. I will try and disconnect and reconnect when we find time right now. Because it is just the servers. It's nothing else. It's not Twitch. It's not us. It's just the Chinese servers. But we're going to wait until... Nice! Oh, the Fissure Block, actually. didn't land that time around. And Shadow Shaman will be able to walk himself away. And with that reveal, I don't think LGD will be caught out. Attack time. Batrider. Yeah, he's just laying down a ward. So I don't think we're going to be seeing any action here in this middle lane. Top Ember Spirit versus the Lifestealer. Lifestealer obviously has a big advantage here because he's two levels up. And then the bottom lane is just going to be a Rubick who's trying to get a deny. Doesn't quite get it. So yeah, no action. We're going to go ahead and disconnect and reconnect real quickly. Try and get rid of some of that Chinese server lag. All in all, though, LGD doing a much better job. I like their response, especially putting the two supports with the Doom. I think they're doing a much better job than they did in game one when it comes to responding to the movements of Green Shoots Gaming. Let's hope this one's a little bit better. Back to the CS board. Yep, there it is. LGD. Top three CS on the board. Of course, OD is rivaling them, and the Batrider. Batrider's right there. And somehow we actually got even worse lag this time around. So we'll try it one more time. Fortunately, it looked like we're having a pretty passive laning phase, so I don't think we'll miss the kill. And I hope you guys are enjoying my double Drow Ranger background. All right, now we have attack animations. Looks like we now have OD animations as well. Okay, some of his animations are missing, but it looks like this should be fine. All right. So going in as looking at the way that the laning phase is going, LGD are getting a bit of a lead. But I think that's kind of to be expected in some ways. I don't think that GSG are actually expecting to walk away with laning advantage here because we've got Viper, who's a strong laner versus the OD, which is a fine matchup. Well, top lane, actually. Lifesteal is going to be caught out here. Commitment here from the Batrider as they need to be able to last him up. He finally gets to the creep. Infest inside of a full health melee creep. And now they actually need this creep to die. And that's why N9, yeah, he's going to strike. Oh my god. He's actually going to go for this kill. N9 can't get away from this one. He doesn't have the mana. The body blocking, but it's not enough. Batrider could not save the Lifestealer there. And that was just GSG not being on the same page. Ember Spirit was trying to force the Lifestealer out, but none of his other allies were ready to be able to respond to that one. And as soon as the Lifestealer had a rage available to him, oh, he's going to go for this one. A couple of right clicks. Earthshaker Fisher needs a couple more. Telekinesis is going to be able to ensure the kill. Maybe he turns around, starts going for Lipe, and he's actually not going to be able to get it. I thought that was an easy kill, but the OD not doing enough damage there. I don't know if he, stutter step too much and maybe missed a couple of right clicks or something, seeing as we're not getting animations. We're getting animations from the illusions. All right, there it goes. But yeah, Green Shoots Gaming certainly not performing the way they did in game one, making a number of mistakes so far, while LGD have cleaned up their game a lot more and don't seem to be being too overly aggressive or anything like that. Batrider's just been caught out and will die here to the Lifestealer. Attempt at a Fisher block from it, but just with the rage, the maxed out rage, by the way, from the Lifestealer. It's too much. Ancient Apparition Ultimate is coming in. Maybe he's going to try and take an advantage of that one. Finally, the animation goes off. So just a poke and a prod, but that's still an Ancient Apparition picking up his level 6, where the supports on the side of Green Shoots Gaming do not have that advantage. Shadow Shaman is now taking some solo experience in the bottom lane, where he will try and pick up his Mass Serpent wards. And once they have those, they can start controlling the map much better. Take down the last two tier 1 towers that are available. Pick up a mech for the Viper. And I think LGD will actually just start steamrolling Green Shoots Gaming. And Green Shoots Gaming certainly want to be angling towards the late game here, I feel, or at least later on into the game. The Viper is too much of a threat this early on into the game. So I don't think they can actually take control before 35 minutes. That should be LGD's This should all be LGD's territory, especially since the laning phase is going so well for them. And N9 is going to be forced to jump away there. As the Ancient Apparition comes to the top lane with an Ice Blast. They should be falling more and more behind as LGD have much more room to be able to farm up. They have their own jungle. They have this bottom lane, which is actually being really well controlled, it looks like, from LGD. This whole entire bottom lane has been abandoned for so long from the side of Green Shoots Gaming. They went and defended their tier 2 once or twice with heroes to farm up the creeps. But other than that, this bottom lane has been completely out. So Green Shoots Gaming certainly getting much less farm out of the map right now. And that's because they're trying to play so defensive against LGD, knowing that there's going to be a big threat. Tier 1 tower going to fall soon, but they're going to be able to fight the kill here. Ancient Apparition's going to go down first. Now maybe being targeted is actually taking a huge amount of damage here from Angel with the burnout of the damage. It's going to be enough to be able to kill him. And now the Lifestealer as well. Rage from Lipe. Not going to be able to do enough there. Angel trying to get close enough for a slight abyss. He's actually committing to this one. Does have chains. Locks him in for a bit of time here. The OT drops the ultimate. It actually misses. Now Angel's going to fall. Good imprisonment there from the OT. As mass teleports begin coming out. Ember Spirit trying to get away. As we do have the Ancient Apparition throwing out an Ice Blast. Not. Oh, it did land. Ember Spirit dies. As he gets sniped there from the Ancient Apparition. Overextending himself. That was a very aggressive play from our Ember Spirit and way too aggressive. He never should have made that jump. He never should have made that pursuit onto the OT, onto the Lifestealer. Now, the OT ultimate was dropped, and it looks like it missed because it really just did nothing to the Lifestealer. Lifestealer does have a decent amount of intelligence, though, thanks to the drums of endurance that he's picked up. So it's possible that maybe we just didn't see the small amount of damage his ultimate did. Because Lifesteal is actually sitting at 43 intelligence compared to the 60 on the OD. So that's not an amazing difference. It's going to be found in the bottom lane and taken out rather quickly. And Mass Serpent Ward's up in just 20 seconds. And this is what I was talking about. Them getting levels on these heroes, and now just 5-man pushing into towers. I expected them to take all the tier 1s, but it looks like they're going to go one step further and this early go for tier 2s now. Batrider in some trouble now. Right-click first in order to disable the Blink Dagger, and now taking him out with the Doom being committed. Nice steal once again from our Rubick as he does grab that ultimate of the Doombringer. Good awareness there as well, taking away a pretty critical offensive ward. That ward from the Radiant side actually gives you a lot of control over Roshan. Because it stops these kind of rotations in, right? You're able to see so much information about the right side of the Roshan pit with those kind of wards. So I think that was pretty key. Jeez. And Angel is not going to be hit by that Ice Blast. He begins to commit to a kill here. He throws out another Remnant. Oh, big critical from the Doom, and that's going to put him over the edge. It was going to be a close fight already. Searing Chains lands, and it looks like Triple Three able to get off that last right click necessary to finish off the Ember Spirit. Now the smoke gank up to the top lane, where maybe is going to be found by the Batrider, and this should be a free pickoff for them. Once again, the Ember Spirit being too aggressive, but at least his allies are making up for it. As they find the kill. Double ultimates, by the way, being dropped from the Rubick. He dropped the Doom on the Viper, which makes sense. You might as well commit it. You may not have another opportunity to throw it down. And then actually stole the Viper Strike and returned it on the Viper as well. So 9-7, 14 and a half minutes in. 4,000 experience lead, 10,000 gold lead for LGD.CDEC. Gonna try reconnecting one more time. But LGD certainly, I don't know, that maybe that first game was just like one of those first game of the day sort of deals. They looked in very, very bad form. Now, GSG seem a little bit shaken up. The response, game one was amazing for them. And they had some great plays, but they've certainly fallen a bit behind from here, especially that Ember Spirit making some poor decisions. As we start going into the mid-game, that's twice now. He's essentially suicided himself into attempts to get more kills. Like, first going for the Doom like that, committing to a man fight, and then after that going for... going for the Lifestealer kill. Now, Sim has done a pretty decent job farming. When you look at the net worth, he's still sitting third despite the gigantic net worth lead here for LGD due to all the towers that have been picked off. Delaying tactics for Green Shoots Gaming, but I don't actually think LGD want to commit to going uphill. I wouldn't want to 16 minutes in, but they're going for it. They are certainly going to go uphill with the Firefly going to be on cooldown now. This is a good opportunity for them if they do want to go this early. Now is the time. There is a lot of spamming abilities, though, on the side of GSG. There's not only the Firefly to put in front, but there's also Fissure blocking as well as Fade Bolts is another nice ability to throw out. Good dodge there from the OD with the Imprisonment. Even the Ember Spirit will have his own ability to be able to defend the base pretty damn well. Now, he's still critically underleveled. He actually went for more levels of Searing Chains over the Sleight of Fist, which you can understand. It's a much more aggressive build. He knows he's going to be doomed out in a lot of team fights, so he wants to provide a larger early to mid-game impact. But it's not working out for him at all. And on top of that, he's actually gimped himself rather heavily by going for the second level of Sleight of Fist rather than the fourth level of Searing Chains, because the fourth level is what gives you a 3-second disable. Now we're going to find the Lifestealer. Question is, do they really have enough stunts to be able to pop him? All the nukes come out, even the Echo Slam, just to ensure that kill. Now maybe he's on hot pursuit. Life is going to try and teleport away. And oh wow, the level death comes in just in time to put a stop to that teleport away. And LGD will find a one-for-one trade. Still favorable, though, for Green Shoots Gaming, as they only lost a support out of that. And the OD is still farming up, so even them grouping up, they're still getting some economy out of the map other than just that kill they received. And that is very important. The OD, his ultimate is, we said this earlier, I mean, it's not as good. The OD pickup wasn't as good as it was in Game 1, I feel. But... we're still dealing with two heroes that are going to be very low intelligence, both the Doom as well as Lifestealer. Lifestealer actually is surprisingly not that bad. He does have, I guess, three different mana costing abilities, so he does actually need to have a mana pool. So his intelligence gain is probably better than many other strength heroes. Strength carry heroes, I should say. But... yeah, I mean, look at this. Viper's sitting at 39 intelligence right now. Lifestealer's actually sitting at 44. The Doom is sitting at 39. You know, that's you look at the intelligence of the OD. If he imprisons somebody, he's going to be sitting about 80. So that's not amazing damage. And that's why he needs to be able to take the time to farm up to get one of those big luxury items. And I think that's going to be the Scythe of Ice for him. And allow his ultimate to actually blow up, have the potential to do good damage to the supports and better damage. Oh, Doom has just been caught out. And even if they do lose Roshan here in the Aegis, it's going to be worth it if they can get the Doom. BKB pop, but they're still going to be able to finish him off. Looks like Light may be picked off again. No, he's going to be fine. There is no extra disables coming out. And the Imprisoned just helping out Rubick a little bit more. So another great Green Shoot Gaming. They were certainly far, far behind, but they're doing all the right things here in order to slow down LGD's push, because LGD should be trying to go uphill. I didn't expect them to try so early on at the top lane. Didn't really think it was worth it there, but I would say by 25 minutes, they have to start going uphill because Green Shoots Gaming do have some amazing defense. It's not necessarily that LGD will have poor late game. I just think that Green Shoots Gaming will have slightly better late game, and on top of that, their mid game, as we get like 35 minutes, they have amazing mid game. Mid to late game, that 35 to 45 minute mark that is going to be tough to deal with, and they are also going to become this amazing turtling squad as well. But before the 25-minute mark, they do have some spamming abilities. It's really, for me, it's like the threat of the OD is not quite apparent. Plus, the Ember Spirit isn't a strong defending force. You can actually see him. He's trying to max out. This is why he gimped himself in the Searing Chains and is not even going for the extra Remnant. Not that that bypassing Remnant is a bad thing by any means. Ember Spirit, it's just extra burst damage, right? And it's really maybe not necessary in an Ember Spirit, but this is why he's doing it. He's trying to get Sleight of Fist to level 4 as soon as possible because he realized the impending threat, which is LGD going uphill very soon. And he needs to be able to have that long-range Sleight of Fist even if he wants to have a hope of being able to spam. This is smart, though. Green Shoots Gaming, I hate seeing teams passively let an enemy team grow an advantage. And this is why I like what they're doing right here, which is going to be smoking up, wrapping around, trying to find a pickoff. They don't go for it, though. As they see too many heroes, they actually back themselves away. Doom is going to be thrown onto the Batrider, and the Lifesteal popping out will be able to finish off the Rubick. Imprisonment helps out the Batrider a bit, but I think he's still going to take out here. No, he's actually fine. He's going to survive here. Buyback now, and the Doom has been caught. That was quite the stretch there from LGD. I cannot believe. Green Shoots Gaming, that was some... I feel like I'm praising these guys maybe a little bit too much, but I just expected them to go for the smoke gank and immediately go for the pickoff. Like, it's right in front of your Tier 3 tower. I expected them to grab somebody and try and drag them in, but the fact that they didn't made all the big difference there. They immediately went back, further back into their base. The Doom had to dive in even further with his BKB and the Infested Lifestealer, and because they dove in so deep and didn't actually get a good, strong, standing engagement. It was a running engagement where Green Shoots Gaming were getting past their Tier 3 tower and even into their Tier 4 towers as LGD tried to initiate like that. Because they didn't get a strong, standing engagement, there wasn't a good target for Doom. He doomed the Batrider, but that was because he wanted to kill, not because Batrider had already thrown everything. Shadow Shaman, no, oh, whoa! Life actually didn't get close enough for a telekinesis. He's going to sit farther back. The rest of his team, okay. Echo Slam being committed there from the Earthshaker. Not sure what that was about. Because he wasn't in range of the Shadow Shaman. I don't think he actually did any damage with his Echo Slam. And he certainly doesn't have a Blink Dagger, so it's not like he just made some sort of mistake there. And got hit by a take of damage and didn't blink or something. So maybe just a straight up misclick. Battle Fury is finished up by the Ember Spirit. Another reason for the maxed out Sleight of Fist. So much priority put into that one. He's made sure he's always had a remnant back to be able to jump to. He recognized the danger of this Doom with a Blink Dagger. He needs to be able to respond very quickly. Because that blink, and then there's a bit of an animation for Doom. And during that animation, you could probably still make your jump away as an Ember Spirit. That scoreboard, I mean, it's stagnating. And sometimes I feel like when you're looking at these kind of lineups, LGD, just because they're holding a 10,000 gold lead isn't actually a good sign. There's some sort of phrase in like when it comes to like business. If you're not growing, then you're dying. And I actually feel that's a very fitting phrase for many of these sort of lineups where even though you're still holding a 10,000 gold lead, you're controlling more of the map. And yet, you aren't actually growing any more economy. Now, that Tier 3 tower going down will certainly help out quite a bit. My point being is you're not actually getting enough an advantage for you to be able to push uphill with confidence, and the game is going later and later. maybe he's going to go down soon. He does, have, of course, have that Aegis, and that's why he's sitting on the front line so much. But they were actually targeting a melee Rax here instead of the range Rax. If they'd gone for the range Rax, I think they could have committed. But they didn't, and now because of it, the both sets of Rax are still alive. Aghanim's upgrade for the Viper. And that's going to be a another helpful spam out ability. But I think this game is going to come down to one very close team fight at this point. Because a tier 3 tower going down by 25 minutes, that's great. You have this range of these racks exposed. You can see how they'll probably be able to at least get the mid set of racks here in the next 5 minutes with the Shadow Shaman wards. That shouldn't be too much of an issue. Eventually, Green Shoots Gaming will run out of smokes, will run out of opportunities to find pickoffs or force team fights outside of the base, and that middle racks will die. My concern is that how long is it going to for them to take the second set of racks? Because one lane of racks down is upsetting, but it's not that bad. Especially with a great hero like Ember Spirit, who is able to farm it up pretty quickly and very efficiently. He's going to go for the kill on Shadow Shaman, it looks like. He didn't actually throw out his Searing Chains. Apparently just wants to farm, not even wanting to get close. Shadow Shaman is, of course, one of the most dangerous heroes to go on underneath the tower because of his single target disable. Looks like they found the Batrider there, and they didn't commit much for it. The Infest was used, but... Okay. I don't know why he felt the need to Ice Blast a Creep Wave, especially since he didn't really need the gold. I don't know what that was about. Odd place. All over today. Scythe of Ice. Ooh, wow. Scythe of Ice picked up by the OD. And now OD is an excellent counter to the Lifestealer. Committing to the range racks once, or the melee racks once again, but a glyph was popped this time around. LGD are going to keep doing this. Oh, there it is. Q actually was able to get off his wards, and the middle racks will go down now. Question is whether or not GSG are going to try and force a fight on top of this. The OD ultimate is dropped. Doom in response now, and the Lifesteal is going to be able to get onto the OD and finish him off. Now, Life, he does what damage he could with the level of death, but it's not going to be enough. Now, N9 actually gets hexed up, but they do have enough defense to be able to get out. Oh, what an Echo Slam! Three-man, four-man Fisher, and with the beautiful Battle Fury Sleight of Fist hits, they're going to be able to clean up all four heroes off of that one. Beautiful play from Earthshaker. And unfortunately, our poor Batrider died from the wards that were still sitting here in the middle lane. But that was huge. That was a great team fight for LGD up until that Earthshaker initiation. Great play by him, showing that that light over here, the Rubik, who played so well in game one and has been doing a pretty damn good job in game two, isn't the only all-star support. Very well played. Additional damage being built. Ember Spirit goes straight for the Crystallis. This is what happens when you're kind of on a crunch time. You would love to be able to build a second Battle Fury. I think that's actually the more preferable build. But if you're on crunch time and you need damage as soon as possible, Crystallis is much easier to build, and it gives you maybe just a little bit of RNG. You can do more damage with the Crystallis, but it's entirely dependent on RNG. More than likely, Battle Fury is the more stable and over time the better damage item. And that's why you see many Ember Spirits in games that their Rax isn't being threatened. He'll go for a double Battle Fury before going for a Crystallis and then into that Daedalus. But this build is meant for being able to provide as much damage as possible as soon as possible. LGD now setting up for another push. I like the fact that they're not spending too much time waiting. They pick themselves up as Shivas, but there's really not much else. Like, you get a Manton, a Viper, but I think that item just doesn't change much about the Viper. The Lifestealer, he's got an S and Y. He's got all mid-game oriented items. The Phase Boots build, the Movement Speed build with Phase Boots drums. He got himself an Armlet, traditional Lifestealer, and then went for an S and Y, which is a very mid-game oriented item. Another set of wards being dropped, and this is the one thing that N9 are having a very hard time dealing with now. Maybe he's going to be dragged back. BKB Doom is going to run forward. OD ultimate did get off, but it didn't do quite enough damage. Maybe he will fall eventually. In response, the OD goes down, as well as the Rubik. The infest damage will be able to finish him off. N9 in some trouble, and going to get bursted down there. He buys back immediately, but that's going to be a second set of racks going down at least here in this bottom lane. Angel needs to make some big plays here, and the jump in from Q actually gets the Hex onto N9, force that forward. Great job by the Batrider, who's going to be able to save him. Angel returns some fire onto the enemy team, but LGD very convincingly taking control of the bottom lane. They get the melee racks, good enough for them. They back themselves away without losing any additional heroes, and this is something that GSG, they move out for a pursuit, unfortunately. They really needed some hero kills there, because now they're two racks down, and that's pretty much the GG. There's not going to be much else Screenshoots Gaming can do, because LGD will just set up now on the top lane. Screenshoots Gaming will never be able to push these lanes out, because they have two different lanes to worry about. It's too hard to deal with both of them. And then LGD will just sit on the top lane and just dive into the buildings over and over again. Even if you have amazing team fights for Screenshoots Gaming and they win two or three team fights in a row, LGD are just going to keep throwing themselves at the buildings. And I'm not even sure that Screenshoots Gaming can win one team fight, let alone two or three. It really required Screenshoots Gaming to initiate outside of the base, and I think that was one of their failures here. If we're going to look back on this, hindsight being 2020, but in general, when you're dealing with heroes like Shadow Shaman, you're dealing with any kind of push lineup, you want to be able to force the fight outside of the base. Try and make it so you either get a fight without Shadow Shaman wards being used, which is obviously a big advantage for you, or they are used and aren't going to be available to take down towers. Now, they're going to be able to initiate Echo Slam, doing a good amount of damage there, holding these heroes in place. Doom is going to fall here in a second. No, he gets off his BKB and gets away. The Ward Trap, though, actually holds in life. It's going to be able to finish off. The Ember Spirit manages to make his jump away, and the poor OD is going to be right-clicked down as maybe takes him out. Batrider going to fall as well. Searing Chains holds him in place for a little bit longer, but the Viper Strike should be able to hold him down long enough. Yeah, GG called. Screenshoots Gaming, no. Even if they could win this fight, it's too much to handle. So, LGD cleaning up their act quite a bit going into game two. And that will now lead us into game three in order to determine who will be one of the qualifying teams for the MSI Beat It 2014 Global from the first Chinese qualifier. Stick around, guys. LGD versus Screenshoots Gaming coming up. Game three.